I got interested in the ocean because I like to swim and I like to snorkel. And when I was a child, only 6 years old, we often went to the Mediterranean Sea in the summer holiday. I was really fascinated on the diversity of life I could see there. So there were many, many colorful fishes, there were many invertebrates, and I got quickly very interested in to really see what these species would be. So I, when we went back the next year, I brought books with me where I could look all the species up, and so I built up also already a knowledge base at that time, what really marine biodiversity could mean and how many species could be there at a single spot. So I think diversity is really the unifying theme of biology and also of marine biology, that really distinguishes it from the other natural sciences like chemistry or physics, where the fundamental laws get simpler and simpler. But in biology, actually, sometimes you feel that the laws get ever more complicated and complex. The future ecosystems will also evolve in the Anthropocene. So the period now in geological history that's very very much influenced by humans. Nevertheless, whether the ocean has a diversity and a function that still sustains vital services to humans, that's our big question. So in effect, protecting the ecosystems is a very anthropocentric question, if you will. Yeah, first and foremost, we have to tell the wider audience, the interested public, as we do this here with the MOOC, what the major facts are, since I think many people, they are not really aware of, first of all, what the ocean is doing for us, and secondly, how activities far inland affect processes in the ocean. For example, application of fertilizers hundreds or even thousands of kilometers inland will affect algal blooms and hence shellfish production, for example, in coastal areas. But then also at the political level, in the political arena, scientists have to speak up. They have to be in the appropriate commissions, working groups, and so on. And also their progress has been made. For example, it's now ocean protection is now one of the top items on the global agenda. And this is very new, and that's a very hopeful sign, I think. I would tell the young students, or maybe not tell, I would first of all try to find out if they're really burning for that topic. If not, I would very strongly discourage them to go into any science topic, in particular into ocean science, because I think that this is not an easy job, and it also requires that you move from places to places, maybe even from continent to continent, and only if you are willing to pay that price you can become a successful scientist. And the condition for that is that you're really, really super interested in the topic. Other than that, I think a general fascination for natural sciences. Also, you should not completely disregard maths, since ocean sciences and also marine biology becomes more and more technical, also theoretical. You also have to take into account that more and more science is done in teams today. So you have to be somebody able to work in teams. I'm generally optimistic that the ocean will survive. I'm not so optimistic if the ocean will survive in a status where it can sustain vital services for humans. On the other hand, to be a bit more positive here, I think there's no ocean region that would not be able to recover if the appropriate management measurements would be taken. So I generally don't like very much doomsday scenarios, because doomsday scenarios are basically dead-end scenarios with no way out. That's something I don't believe in. So no matter how desperate a status of a world ocean could be, there's always a way slowly, and it takes probably a lot of patience, but to have that part of the ocean, that region or that coastline back into a, not into a pristine status, of course, but into a status where the ecosystems are back on track, are functioning and are diverse at a reasonable level.